Hachette Audio presents A Hard Kick in the Nuts, What I've Learned from a Lifetime of Terrible Decisions, written by Stephen Steve O. Glover with David Peisner, read by Stephen Steve O. Glover. Introduction. Age is way more than just a fucking number. This book started as a joke. I mean, how could it not? The very idea that I would be writing a book to impart my wisdom to others, that people would be coming to me, a recovering alcoholic drug addict who once willingly tried to cross a pit full of alligators on a tightrope while wearing a jockstrap, for advice about anything is clearly absurd. Surely, if you're looking to Steve-O for help with your life, you are well and truly fucked, right? Well, maybe. Let me allow you behind the curtain for a second here. I wrote a book about 12 years ago. Maybe some of you read it. It chronicled my insane, near-suicidal descent into drugs, booze, and, well, near-suicidal insanity, and then my slow crawl back from the edge. When that book came out, I was freshly sober, the third Jackass movie had just been a number one box office hit, and I had recently started to tour as a stand-up comedian. So, smooth sailing and happily ever after, right? Not exactly. For starters, I was only 36 years old when that book came out. For a long time, I had thought there was no way I'd live to even be that old. The way I had been going, I don't think many people would have bet on it. Even putting aside all the booze and drugs, I'd spent most of my teenage and adult years doing incredibly foolish, often quite dangerous stunts, and occasionally getting paid for it. But there I was in my mid-30s, very much alive, and realizing that if the average life expectancy stats were accurate, I probably wasn't even halfway through my journey. While most people would greet this realization as a profound gift, I guess I'm not most people. I freaked the fuck out. Getting older has always scared the shit out of me, and I had long figured that I'd avoid having to deal with it by doing the sensible thing and dying young. With that option now seemingly off the table, I was looking at the possibility of having more than half a lifetime ahead of me, during which the body I'd relied on for my livelihood would be breaking down, my earnings potential would be dropping precipitously, and the public spotlight that I'd ached for since birth would be gradually receding. Being an old attention whore is not a good look. I was overcome with anxiety about what the hell I was going to do with the rest of my life and how I was going to eat. If you're thinking that this is the point where I tell you that's why I got loaded again, it's not a bad guess, but fortunately, I didn't. I'm fairly certain that would have killed me, or if it didn't, I would have been better off if it had. But I did do all sorts of other ridiculous, self-destructive shit that made the next decade at least as harrowing as the ones before it. Although I've managed to stay sober, sobriety for me is kind of a moving target. The last 10 plus years have been like a game of addiction whack-a-mole. Sex, sugar, fame, work, spending, meditation. You name it, I probably have a problem controlling my impulses for it. I've spent large parts of the last decade on some frighteningly irresponsible sexual benders. I've been a maniacally strict vegan who won't shut up about his healthy, ethical food choices, and the kind of guy who can polish off an entire bag of fun-sized Butterfingers in one sitting. I had myself hoisted up onto a Hollywood billboard and duct taped to it to promote my comedy special, scaled a 150-foot construction crane and got thrown in jail for it to protest SeaWorld, and climbed nearly 19,000 feet up a mountain in Peru with a bunch of YouTube stars to prove I wasn't a dick. Yeah, dude, I'm fun. I know, none of this is making a compelling case for me as America's next great self-help guru. Shit, I can barely help myself, so should I really be dishing out advice to anyone else? My life in sobriety has been about as turbulent a roller coaster ride as it was before I got clean. But as I started thinking about that roller coaster ride, I realized that if you looked hard and in the right places, there were enough little nuggets of wisdom to be found to suggest I've actually learned some valuable shit from my lifetime of terrible decisions. I don't want to overstate the usefulness of this book. It's still like 90% tales of reckless abandon and often criminal stupidity. But that leaves a solid 10% that might actually help some people in how they think about their lives, about growing older, and about whether or not doing snow angels in flaming rocket fuel on their living room floor is a good idea. Spoiler alert, it's definitely not. I'll give you an example of what I'm talking about. A few years ago, I was in bad shape. Now, if you know anything about me and my history, this will be about the least surprising sentence you'll read in this book. So let me be a little more specific. This was 2013. I'd been sober for about 5 years by then. I wasn't face down, lifeless and bloody on a patch of pavement after drunkenly throwing myself off a balcony to impress some girl. That was 1995. I wasn't laid up in a hospital bed after setting myself on fire. That could have been 1997 or 2017. I wasn't even in jail. That could have been so many dates I won't bother to list them all here. Yet, I was still in very bad shape. At the particular moment that I want to zoom in on, I was having sex in El Salvador, which, I know, doesn't actually sound all that bad. But I'd been engaging in a lot of risky sex that year, for reasons I promise I'll get into later on. There was sex with lots of strangers, some of whom I knew just enough about to know that having sex with them could be potentially very unhealthy. Plus, I was nearly 40 at the time. It's one thing to be a 23-year-old dude trying to fuck everything that moves. That's kind of what 23-year-old dudes do. But at this point, I was quickly becoming that sad middle-aged loser who is the last one to realize what a sad middle-aged loser he is becoming. After each one of these encounters, I'd feel awful and filled with self-loathing. Yet it wouldn't be long before I'd be balls deep in another one. After a particularly troubling one of these couplings, I knew I had to do something about it. That's when I flew to El Salvador to surf, meditate, read, get my mind right, and most importantly, not have sex. Instead, when I got there, I surfed, meditated, read, and then met a random chick from Canada who was backpacking through Central America. Which brings us back to me having sex in El Salvador. It wasn't the act itself that was so problematic, or even the partner. It was knowing, even while in the very throes of this one-night stand, that I was in the middle of doing the one thing I'd promised myself I wasn't going to do. It was the recognition that I was out of control again. On my way back to California, I was disgusted with myself. Shortly after I got home, I went to a therapist who recommended an intensive outpatient sex addiction program. There, I was told that a period of celibacy, maybe a month or two, can help to rewire your brain to reduce the compulsive desire for sexual release. It's a way to jumpstart learning a healthier approach to sex. That sounded exactly like what I needed, so I went all in on celibacy. No sex, no jerking off, no heavy petting, no nothing. If I was even having a wet dream, I'd somehow wake myself up before it actually got wet. That's commitment. And then I did this for 431 days. For those doing the math, that's almost 15 months without shooting a load. But why? I can imagine some of you are thinking right now. Well, that's the point I want to make. The reason why is because that's who I am. It's the way I'm wired. I take everything too far. I always have. Since I was a kid, my brain told me, if eating one bowl of Fruity Pebbles is good, eating a whole box will be 20 times better. In fact, I distinctly remember being pissed off that Fruity Pebbles didn't come in a bigger box. What I've learned about myself is that there's pretty much nothing I go halfway on. I turn just about everything I do into drugs. Look, did that period of celibacy help me? It did, actually. Did it help any more than it would have if I had done it for 60 days? I doubt it.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.